The following program is brought to you by Arlington Community Media, where we tell your story.
This is ACMi News, recognized nationwide as the first place winner of the 2023 Hometown Media Award for News Access.
Two questions, yes or no, for or against an override for the town, and for or against a senior tax exemption. We'll tell you how many voters turned out at the polls for this fall's special election. ACMi News interviews Secret Service agent Clint Hill, the only surviving occupant of JFK's presidential limousine that awful day in Dallas, November 22nd, 1963, 60 years ago. An upcoming half-hour ACMi News special is also airing later on this month. We'll tell you when. And the Arlington International Film Festival is another success at Arlington's Capitol Theater. One timely film in particular, Against All Enemies, was featured on opening night. Is it a barometer of things to come 1 year out now from the next presidential election? ACMi News starts right now.
From McLennan Park to Spy Pond, from Poets Corner to the Mystic River, we have Arlington covered, giving you stories that count from people who care. Reliable, trustworthy, dependable. This is the nationwide award-winning ACMi News.
Arlington voters have spoken in the November special election that raised two questions: whether to raise taxes by $7 million to fund the operating budgets of the town and public schools, and whether there should be a senior citizen property tax exemption. Hello, I'm Ben Lau.
And I'm Summer Maxwell, glad you could join us. Unofficial election results as of this broadcast show both special election ballot questions passed on November the 7th. Question one, yes votes on the property tax override question, won handily with nearly 8,000 voting in the affirmative to nearly 5,000 no votes. And for question two, the senior citizen property tax exemption, it was a rout with nearly 11,000 votes in the affirmative to nearly 1,950 votes. The town clerk's office says voter turnout was about 40% of all registered voters in Arlington at nearly 13,000 votes. ACMi News was at Town Hall and got reaction from those taking part in the town's future.
It's really important to invest in Arlington and ensure that we have an override to support the community, the schools, ensure teachers have the salaries that they deserve, and increase our tax base.
This pays back in dividends. You know, if we fund our schools, it just, you know, In the long run, we end up saving a lot of money because we get, you know, well-educated, future generations, and it just, you know, kind of like, you know, goes around and comes around and helps everyone out. So I think this is something worth funding.
It's especially important in a town election because you're more directly involved in what's going on than you may be not one of the mass as you would be for a federal or a state.
It's extremely important. I mean, there's a 2.5% increase every year. Our inflation has increased more than that, so it's logical to have an override.
I realize that we do need the money in the town to improve the schools and other necessities, but of course it's always harmful to the people who can't make it.
Still, both ballot questions passed. The property tax increase takes effect starting July 1st, 2024. As always, unofficial results were made available on the election and voting webpage once the polls closed and all votes were tallied. Get the latest information on how this vote will affect you by going to the town website, arlingtonma.gov/elections. Again, that's arlingtonma.gov/elections.
ACMi News told you about the passage of Article 12 in October's special town meeting by a vote of 189 to 35. That article is the highly charged rezoning issue, which allows more multifamily housing in Arlington. And it's been a long process with passions running high among Arlington residents. So what's next on the town schedule? ACMi's James Milan recently talked to Claire Ricker, the director of Arlington's Department of Planning and Community Development, about what we can expect in the coming weeks.
My next steps are I need to submit our zoning to the state and to the Attorney General's office. Just like usual, our usual zoning amendments are reviewed by the AG. So the AG's office has about 90 days to review. The Executive Office of Housing and Livable Communities, which is the body that is sort of managing the MBTA communities program, will be reviewing the district for compliance in a parallel process. So we are shooting for both reviews to be done and our compliance to be achieved by February 11th, so that the town can participate in the fossil fuel free demonstration program, which was also adopted in the last couple of weeks by the fall town meeting. The fossil fuel demo would allow us to begin to decouple, from our dependence on natural gas. New construction, like anything built under the MBTA communities overlay, will not be allowed to get a gas hookup or without a waiver. And this also sort of aligns with the specialized stretch code, which was passed last spring by town meeting, where any new construction to be built will be designed to passive house design if it's over a certain size, or will be wired for future electric energy if indeed they are going to try to pursue a waiver for natural gas. And I just want to say, now that we're sort of on the other side of it, just so many thanks to the MBTA working group, just an inspiring bunch of people who really committed to this process and were dedicated to seeing it through. That group was dissolved with the end of town meeting. Also, thank you to the redevelopment board, to my staff here, and also especially to the public who remained, so engaged in this and, made some very thoughtful comments that I hope we were responsive to, so there's more work to come. But I really did want to acknowledge these efforts.
If you want to know more about this historic vote on zoning bylaws, just go to the town website, arlingtonma.gov/ZBA. Again, that's arlingtonma.gov/ZBA. And to see James's interview with Ms. Ricker in its entirety, just go to our YouTube channel, youtube.com/ACMiNews. Again, that's youtube.com/ACMiNews.
For those people old enough to remember, this is hard to believe. But this November the 22nd will mark 60 years to the day since our 35th President John F. Kennedy was felled by an assassin's bullet in Dallas, Texas. At the end of this month, ACMi News will air an exclusive half-hour interview with the only surviving member of the presidential limousine on that day that forever changed our nation's history. Clint Hill was a Secret Service agent under five presidential administrations, from Presidents Dwight Eisenhower to Gerald Ford. When JFK was sworn into office in 1961, Mr. Hill was assigned to protect First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy. That's why Clint Hill was in Dallas, Texas on November 22, 1963. Hill and his wife, Lisa McCubbin, have penned a nationwide bestseller, My Travels with Miss Kennedy, a fascinating account of those 1,000 days that were tragically cut short and sparking countless what-ifs that still resonate today. Here now is an excerpt from news director Jeff Barnes' interview with Lisa McCubbin and Clint Hill.
She always called you Mr. Hill, and you always addressed the First Lady as Mrs. Kennedy. There's a bond that I'm sure she didn't have with any other Secret Service agent. I mean, you could, and in this book you mentioned it, you could see her look, and you knew exactly what she needed, wherever she was, and whatever stress she was facing. You could almost read minds.
That's it. She wanted to test the how far she could go, or how far what she could do. She was very good. I mean, she's just a wonderful person to work with. It was a different relationship toward the end.
In Dallas, Texas, three shots were fired at President Kennedy's motorcade in downtown Dallas. The first reports say that President Kennedy has been seriously wounded by this shooting.
If I had reacted just a little bit quicker, I could have, I guess. I'll live with that to my grave.
Well, in a sense, I've made peace with it, and I understand it fully. I still feel that we failed. I still feel a sense of guilt that I wasn't able to do more than I did faster. But I understand there's only so much you can do. So, and it wasn't until I met Lisa in 2009 that I just started talking about what had happened and everything, because I'd never discussed it with anybody. Talked to the Warren Commission, they asked pointed questions, but I really never talked to anybody. No agents, none of my family members, I never talked to anybody. None of the agents actually did. It was just too, and some of them, even after we were writing books and things, I remember going to one agent and saying to him, "Hey, Don, I want to ask you some questions." He said, "Clint, I can't talk about that day. It's just too painful." And I mean, this was years later, so I wasn't the only one affected. Many, many, many people were affected.
That ACMi News special will air in Arlington beginning Friday, November the 24th, right here on ACMi TV. For more information on this or any other ACMi newscasts, just go to our website, acmi.tv. Again, that's acmi.tv.
ACMi News is proud to be sharing the same beat as Your Arlington, the local news website founded by longtime Arlington resident Bob Sprague. And to celebrate Your Arlington, there will be an event honoring Bob at the Donut Villa this November 15th from 7 to 9:30. The evening is to feature a talk by prominent media commentator Dan Kennedy, tributes from state and local officials, delicious food and drinks, and a public celebration of Sprague's 17 years of work at Your Arlington. Emceeing this special occasion will be ACMi News Director Jeff Byrne, who talked to Bob during special town meeting about the importance of local journalism. Bob is stepping back as chief editor of Your Arlington, but he's not going anywhere.
I've decided not to be the editor of Your Arlington anymore, and that happened last July. Judith Pfeffer is the editor. I've done this long enough, but I love it. So I'm still president of the board of the nonprofit Your Arlington, and on November the 15th at Donut Villa, they'll be honoring me. What can I say?
Give us all the information so that people can buy the tickets, or they're probably going to go fast.
Basically, you go to yourarlington.com and look in the upper right corner, and you'll see the promotional information. Just click that link, and you'll find how to get tickets.
Again, this event will be in the back room of Donut Villa on November 15th from 7 to 9:30 p.m. If you want more information, just go to Bob's website, yourarlington.com, for all the details. And we hope to see you there.
Arlington's International Film Festival just wrapped up this week. The festival took place November 2nd through the 5th at the Capitol Theater on Mass Ave. This was a chance for so many film directors, producers, and actors to feature films that have a profound impact on all of us, films from all over the world. One film making its Arlington debut was Against All Enemies, a documentary that explores the roots of political radicalization and its impact on our country. ACMi News Director Jeff Barnd emceed this event and talked to the filmmakers about some of our veterans joining extremist groups like the Three Percenters, Oath Keepers, and Proud Boys, some of whom were at the U.S. Capitol on January 6, 2021. Against All Enemies is showing at a time when this nation is less than a year out from what is sure to be a divisive general election.
This year's festival began with a timely documentary, Against All Enemies, a film that explores the roots of political radicalization and its impact on a constitutional republic. The filmmakers are embedded with extremist groups like the Oath Keepers, whose members include highly trained, highly motivated U.S. military veterans who took an oath to defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic. Filmmakers say January 6, 2021 at the U.S. Capitol was more or less a trial run for what may come in the future, which may include the 2024 general election, 1 year from this week.
Michael Flynn! Yeah! as a lot of people in the film point out, that the election coming in November is sort of a pivot point to see where the country is going. We're worried about both actual violence, but also what Asosa Osa in the film calls bureaucratic violence. The idea that Bill Kristol puts out there, that the election could be stolen from within by people who don't certify the election, by people who aren't elected, duly elected. So that's something that people are legitimately scared of.
This movie is the wake-up call. January 6th was a wake-up call, but this film is a wake-up call.
Thank you. I think it's important to acknowledge that January 6th, for a lot of the actors, was not some culmination. It was a practice run. Mm-hmm. And that should really be a wake-up call to all of us.
This is almost like a rebranding of hate. This is nothing new. After the film, there was a Q&A for roughly an hour with the filmmakers, who say while most veterans are successful in their transition to civilian life, after our longest wars in our nation's history, an increasingly radicalized element has been drawn into the insurrectionist movement. And Against All Enemies producer Ken Harbaugh should know. He's a former Navy pilot and combat recon mission commander.
Hate is nothing new. I mean, we have experienced this as a country from our inception. I think what is almost new, and I qualify it intentionally, is the way a major political party has been co-opted by a hateful movement. Almost new because you have to go back to the Civil War or the second iteration of the KKK. And if that's instructive, it's terrifying. Because when the KKK co-opted a major American political party, it held sway for a century and terrorized a major region of the country because it had the Democratic Party in the South in its grip. Mm-hmm. And if the GOP goes down that path and becomes beholden to a violent extremist organization, as increasingly individual members have become, then I think it is a new thing in this country when you have a major political party on the eve of an election with an extremist ideology.
And as far as a release date for Against All Enemies?
We're going to be releasing it on January 6, 2024, and we'll have some information about where you can be seen, and then we also hope to roll it out across the country in various grassroots ways at smaller theaters, libraries, community centers, what have you, as you said, get people talking about it in person.
And how about a website? Do you have a website? Because we'll direct them to that in the news.
AgainstAllEnemiesFilm.com.
That website, once again, is AgainstAllEnemiesFilm.com. Again, AgainstAllEnemiesFilm.com.
For the past 6 months, ACMi teamed up with the Cyrus Dallin Art Museum to piece together a major project which focuses on one of Arlington's favorite sons, the world-renowned sculptor Cyrus Dallin. ACMi produced a multi-series oral histories program, area residents reading first-hand accounts of people who came in contact with this master artist and have a fascinating story to tell. This week, a modern-day Arlington artist pays tribute to Dallin and his love of the ancients who were here long before us. Dallin was in touch with their respect for nature. It was a valuable message in the time of Dallin and, in our own time, a dire warning.
It could be that an artist affects their times through some exciting synergy between their work, their lifestyle, and the fashion of the times. We hear about the Impressionists and maybe even long for their riotous evenings in Paris. But that time is long past, and it probably has very little effect on our culture anymore. Now, however, we can perhaps get the real effect of the artist as people pause one by one and are moved by their paintings. This is a direct emotional communication and transmits the actual intention of the artist and the real effect of their art on our time. In Boston, there's a sculpture that has been having a profound effect on the visitors to the Museum of Fine Arts for over 100 years. Known as the Appeal to the Great Spirit, it is a full-scale bronze of a Native American on a horse. His arms wide, he leans back, opening his heart to the heavens above. It is green with age and exposure because it is entirely appropriately outdoors, under the elements and the sky. This is a sculpture that has greeted visitors to the museum since 1910. And from all accounts, it is the best loved sculpture in Boston. It is said to be after the Daniel French sculpture of Lincoln seated in his memorial in Washington, D.C., the most photographed sculpture in the United States. How strange that almost nobody knows which artist created it. Beside any of the paintings inside the museum, one glances without fail at the tag that announces the artist. In front of the appeal, however, people stop and gaze and then move on, receiving its gift of inspiration with almost the same unconscious acceptance as they take in the sky above it. And it has been having an effect. Bit by bit, person by person, Cyrus Dallin has been selflessly reminding us of the world above us and the Native Americans who valued it. There is no accident that scarcely anybody knows who did this. The surrender of the rider is not one of the overt values of the American spirit. Still, in the privacy of our hearts, we may love it and know that there is truth in this profound gesture of appeal. Americans of Dallin's era preferred the active, swashbuckling style of Frederick Remington and other Western artists. To this day, Remington's work and name applaud the romantic images of the combative, dominating, totally independent cowboy. But as Jonathan Fairbanks, curator emeritus of decorative arts at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston, said in a lecture, Cyrus Dallin was born in the West. He knew too much to think that such brash images were the reality. Not only did Dallin avoid that stereotype, he saw in the Native Americans values that he felt were much deeper and more sincere. These are not the motives of the men who tamed the West, nor the culture that has conquered nature. Rather, his sculptures speak of reverence, humility, inspiration, and a deep emotional awareness of another's pain. In a park in Philadelphia, there's a bronze Native American on a bronze horse. He is ceremonially naked, with his arm raised in a curious, gentle gesture. His hand does not welcome, neither does it try to stop. Only when one contemplates the old man's face can one feel the depth of his pain, his witness to the destruction of his own culture. Then one can hear the words in his gesture, peace, enough. Peace, enough. Very few people wanted to hear this message when it was created in 1903. But perhaps now we are more capable of acknowledging the facts that this man has witnessed. In being open to his pain, we can also open the door to feeling the values of his culture. There is a small park in Arlington, Massachusetts, behind the town hall. Grass and bushes flank a broad spillway that falls like a small stream from a rise in the copse of trees behind. It is a beautiful refuge on a summer's day, and the few who know it come there to sit on a stone bench and eat their lunch in sheltered peace. Tucked away in the copse of trees at the top of the rise, there is a bronze hunter, crouching down to scoop a drink from the running stream that is the source of the fountain. Though larger than life size, you could miss this sculpture entirely, because it expresses humility and a simple participation in its natural setting.
Alongside this Native American, Dallin has sculpted a dead goose, the hunter's rightful share of the bounty that he inhabits. In 1912, when Dallin sculpted this work, American culture was at the height of its headlong consumption of the resources of a new continent. Only now, as we near the end of this enormous banquet and begin to consider curbing our appetite, can we discover an artist like Dallin and begin to absorb the values he expressed. Although appreciated for the sheer skill of his sculpture during his life, Dallin's intentions could not be fully appreciated in his own time, and his name has been forgotten. His sculptures stand today in front of a museum in Boston, on a hill overlooking Kansas City, in a park in Philadelphia, and they testify to the values of the culture that we displaced. They show the qualities that we now need to resurrect and encourage. This reverence, humility, this awareness of the pain of others. These are not the values of those who conquered nature, but of those who may one day, hopefully soon, learn to live with her.
Few museums in the world are located in the town where the artist actually lived and worked. We are among the select few. For more of the life and time of Cyrus Dallin, just go to the website of the Dallin Art Museum, dallin.org. Again, that's dallin.org. That's Dallin.
Off season for the Spy Ponders. Let's go to Nick Antonakis, who's standing by at Pierce Field for the latest update. Nick?
While temperatures are dropping here in Arlington, playoff action is heating up for our Spy Ponders. Starting off with the girls varsity soccer squad, they were at home for their opening playoff matchup against Braintree, getting a huge 2-0 win over Braintree. Because of that, their playoff journey will continue. Now, a team that was on the road for their opening playoff matchup, the football squad, unfortunately lost by a score of 34-0 against Peabody High School. Their season isn't over yet, however, as they travel back here to Pierce Field this Friday, November 10th, for a huge consolation bracket matchup against Hingham. Kickoff is at 6 p.m. From ACMi Sports, I'm Nick Antonakis.
Thanks, Nick. That'll do it for this week's edition of ACMi News. I'm Ben Lau.
And I'm Summer Maxwell. Thanks, as always, for joining us. Do you want to see how we put together the newscast here in Arlington? Stop by and pay us a visit right here at 85 Park Ave on Thursday afternoons between 3 and 5 p.m.
And if you have any news tips for us, stay tuned. In just a few seconds, you'll find out how.
And we will see you back here next week. Take care, everyone.
You can always check out our latest segments and newscasts on the web at acmi.tv/news. And don't forget to like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter and Instagram at ACMi News. Make sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel as well. You'll find us at youtube.com/ACMi News. If you have any news tips for us or wish to become a citizen journalist, we'd love to hear from you. Email us at news@acmi.tv or stop by ACMi Studio A at 85 Park Avenue.